Welcome to FirstFleet tenFour. My name is Elizabeth Windham, and I am joined for a very special podcast with two very special gents, Mr. Rob Getz and Mr. Scott Barcinas. So I know Scott is based out of Colorado, Fountain, I believe. Is that right?
Yes.
Wonderful. And Mr. Rob Getz is now based out of Murfreesboro, although you used to work out west.
Yeah, I actually opened up Fountain, Colorado in 1999, and Scott was one of our first drivers, probably came along in the first 12 or 18 months, if my memory serves. Glad to have Scott on here today. Like Eli said, we're featuring our vets on some of these podcasts in different areas of the country, and Scott came to mind. Scott has been with FirstFleet's 21-year driver based in Fountain, Colorado.
Wow.
Scott, how long did you serve in the military?
Well, first of all, thanks for having me. I was in the military just a little less than 10 years, from 1987 to 1997. I got out in 97.
Great, great. And yep, I was going to ask, tell us all which branch you were in the Army, and you were in, you know, what was your day-to-day function?
Well, I joined as an 88 Mike, and that's transportation in the Army. So I went to basic training in Fort Leonard Wood, 88 Mike.
88 Mike. That makes much more sense. Yes. I'm so sorry. Thank you.
88 Mike. So I went to basic training and did my AIT in Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. Then after my training in Fort Leonard Wood, they shipped me to Fort Stewart, Georgia with the 24th Infantry Division. And I got assigned to the third of the 7th Company Infantry Company. So I had nothing to do with my MOS that I went to training for. I was in infantry for almost the first 5 years.
Oh, wow.
And then after Desert Storm, when we got back in 91, I re-enlisted to make sure I got sent to a transportation company. And then I did my last 5 years in Germany at a transportation company, driving tractor trailer, hauling everything from mail to heavy loads to dry goods. The only thing we didn't do was any reefer stuff.
Very good. Very interesting. So
cool.
In those 10 years, what sticks out in your mind? What are some of your favorite memories, Scott?
Just bonding with the guys, because you have guys that come from all over the United States. You know, we each have different characters, different backgrounds, and just spending time with those guys and bonding with them and doing things with them on the weekend was very special. Like, you know, when we're in Georgia, you know, we're not too far from the beach and going down to Florida and doing that. And as of today, I still talk to all those guys. So you're bonding and you're forming a lifetime friendship with them.
That's fantastic. You were in transportation in Germany. What, if any, differences could you point out as to what it's like driving heavy equipment on the highways in Germany versus the United States?
Well, over there, I believe that was like 30 years ago. The training we did when we got there, we did like a month training, but that was just basically just to learn the German laws over there, of the highways and all that. And our trucks were only governed at 55. So, and plus you have the Autobahn over there, right? And that's one thing you have to pay attention to is the cars out there, because you could be driving and look in your mirror and there's nobody behind you. Then all of a sudden there's a Mercedes or an Audi or a BMW coming up on you really quick. So
you were doing 55 miles an hour on the Autobahn when you've got people doing 100.
Oh yeah. Yeah. It was crazy.
That's a level of risk. That's interesting.
Oh, there were so many accidents. It was just crazy. You know, you'd see a motorcyclist, you know, blowing past you and all of a sudden he's on the side of the road. So, you know, but yeah.
Interesting. That was going to be one of my questions, if you had any experience driving on the Autobahn, and you beat me to it. So that's always fascinating. I'm a bit of a car guy. So that's a bucket list item for me to get over there and drive on that.
I did do it one time with my father-in-law's Mercedes.
I was wondering.
A Mercedes dealer, and he had me pick up my Mercedes in Mannheim, Germany, and I had to drive it back to Berlin, Germany. And I just wanted to see what it actually would do. So I got in that left lane. I think I got up to about 120. I know it went faster, but, you know, I started like, no, this is my limit right here. So, you know, because you come up with those little hills there, you don't know what's on the other side. So,
right.
You know,
Scott, could you tell us a little bit about your experience as a veteran working with First Fleet, and maybe even talk about, I think I know some of your early assignments with First Fleet in Fountain, because we were doing some pretty interesting and unique business at the time. Could you just kind of walk us through, you know, how that worked, you know, as a veteran, all the things First Fleet, you know, 21 years ago, because it's a little bit different experience than what it is today.
Yeah, as a veteran working here, it's great. You know, they acknowledge you as a veteran. You know, of course, you know, we live. First Fleet's terminal here is less than a mile from one of the main gates here on Fort Carson. So, you know, this whole community here acknowledges veterans, you know. So that's great. And we have a lot of veterans that work at this terminal. And when I first got here in 2002, I got hired here in 2002, wasn't much going on because, you know, at the bottom of the board, you know, but at the time we had mini marts, quick shops. And at the time we were going to Kansas, but we were only going to Goddard. It was just a cross dock in Goddard, in Kansas. And then we had just started the Texas run. So one of the guys left and they called me one morning and wanted to know if I wanted to do a mini mart. And I said, sure. Where's that? And it was all the way up in Grand Forks, North Dakota. He did all North Dakota and across into Montana. So, and at that time, I never driven on snow. So really? I had to learn very quickly. But that was a good experience, you know.
Sure.
And then the quick shops we did, those are brutal. Those are like anywhere between 22 to 26 stops on a trailer.
You were kidding.
You had to hand unload the whole trailer by yourself at the quick shops.
Was there a dock or were you like dolly?
No, we had ramps on the trailer. Yeah.
That's hard work.
Hand truck.
And side doors. We had a frozen compartment and a refrigerated compartment that came out of the side doors of those trailers. So very, very physical experience.
Yeah, you can't be an older guy doing that. I mean, so that was my first experience here, probably the first year or so at First Fleet doing those. And then and mainly from there, it was Dillon stores in Wichita, Kansas, and over Kansas, basically. You know, I wasn't high enough in seniority to get any Texas runs. And then in 2006, for about a year, I did the Tri-Cor team run, where we go from Fountain to Phoenix, Arizona, then from Phoenix, Arizona to Grand Junction, Colorado, then to Denver, then back down to Fountain. So I did that for about a year. And after that, I jumped on. High enough in seniority, I got two Texas runs and a Kansas and did that for probably about 5 or 6 years. And then in 2012, I jumped back on the Tri-Cor team run and did that for 7 years.
And you must have had a good partner.
Well, I did have good partners.
How long of a run
in
is
2019,
that?
I jumped back on Texas.
I think to answer your question on the team runs to and from Phoenix, I think that's about 100 hours a week in the truck. Is that right, Scott?
It's about what?
100 hours per week in the truck?
You're in that truck a long time, right? Wow. Yeah, the only day off we had was, the only time we were home was Friday evening. And I just remember times when I'm at home Friday evening, I'd be passed out like 8 o'clock at night because it was just such a long week.
Sure.
Because, you know, it's hard to sleep in a moving truck and you got to trust your partner. You know, I had three partners. They're all good partners. So, yeah.
How did that affect your home life, work life balance? I mean, nutrition, life on the road. I mean, that's a tough life.
Yeah. Being on the team run is tough. I pack my own food.
Oh, did you?
I don't eat out much. Yeah. So, and sometimes when we go down to Phoenix, we have like a 2-hour layover. We'll go maybe have breakfast, you know, at IHOP or something, you know. Just and the exercise, it's hard to exercise. You just have no energy to exercise.
Sure.
So, because before I was doing the team run, you know, I went to the gym all the time and, you know, and I started doing the team run. You know, I tried going to the gym, you know, on the days I'm here, but it's just the energy, you know, I didn't really have the energy to do that.
That makes sense. That would be a tough, very tough life.
That's a tough run.
Scott, this is Rebecca. Earlier, we interviewed Kayleen Chatham and Conrad Murak, two of our employees that are veterans. And I think it was interesting today when you said bond, you talked about one of your memories was the bond that you had with those others that you met in the service. And that was your first answer today. And then transferring that over to First Fleet, our core values. And they both agreed that when you're in the service, you have this bond and you have these core values that you live and work for. And then it's nice to come to First Fleet and see that we work off of core values, that we trust each other and we have a bond with each other. And so I think it was really interesting that you brought that same thing up today, and wondering if you feel like as you bring this over to First Fleet, you see that trust and core values, you see that in your dispatchers and your shop and your other drivers.
Yes, I do. Like I said, there's a lot of veterans here, so, and we all bond with each other, you know, like just like we would have done in the service.
Right.
It's great camaraderie. And I see it, you know, here in Fountain, it's all about family.
It is.
Right? Being with your family. And I say all the veterans are part of my family.
That's right. It's very visible when you're there that it is a family. You see spouse, you know, family members. And I think it's something that it's a place where families welcome. And we're proud of that as well.
Absolutely. We just celebrated our 25th year anniversary in Fountain, Colorado. And it was pretty interesting to see the grandchildren of some of the employees that I can remember, you know, getting married or had just been married. And now they've got their grandchildren there with them. So that ages me a little bit, but it does reinforce, you know, it's a generational, it's a family thing. And I always say trucking is a family business. Doesn't matter if you're a driver or what you're doing to move the company forward. If you don't have support of your family, it's going to be that much more difficult. And I'm proud of our crew in Fountain, Colorado, drivers, technicians, and staff. They've done a very good job of cultivating that family atmosphere and living our core values.
Hey, Scott, this is Piper. So as Rob said, you've been driving with us for 21 years and then before that in the military. So I was wondering what kind of lessons you could depart on kind of new drivers and someone who might be thinking about joining the trucking industry.
Yeah, well, after I got in the military, I didn't come to First Fleet right away. So when I got out, I drove for KLM and that just wasn't my thing, cross country, being 2 weeks out at a time and come home and, you know, for one day and the next day they're calling you to go back out. So, and, you know, I only did that with them for about a month. And then I delivered a distributed steel around the Bay Area, Northern California for 5 years. And then I came over here to First Fleet just because the cost of living was too much in California. So I still had a few friends here stationed on Fort Carson. And actually one of them was here working at First Fleet on the weekends, I believe. And he's the one that helped me get the job here at First Fleet. And your question about new drivers coming to First Fleet or?
Yes, sorry. But what kind of like the lessons you've learned driving for so many years, what would you tell a new driver? What kind of advice would you give them?
Oh, yes. Number one thing is be patient out here on the road because it seems like it's getting worse every year with people are just in a rush and they're impatient. And you have to be patient out here on the road. There's times that somebody will cut you off and you just want to, you know, give them the middle finger or something, but don't do that. Just, you know, be patient. And if a new driver is getting hired at First Fleet, I would say be patient about the seniority. Okay. I know a lot of them get frustrated when they're on the bottom of the board. They're trying to get runs and they can't, you know, we all been there on the bottom of the board. And another thing is take time off. If you have kids or a family, my only regret was I didn't take enough time off for birthdays or anniversaries or holidays or, you know, school functions for the kids. You know, I'd say if you have a young family, I would take birthdays off and anniversaries and all that. So
very good advice. I agree. The work-life balance is kind of a phenomenon that the latest generations have brought to us, but I think there's a lot of value in that. And that's been one of our things for 28 years, I guess, that we've always been encouraged to use our PTO because we need it. I can remember our founder, Gary Wilson, saying that very clearly and very plainly many, many times, take it because you need it, you know, because we work hard. So when you're working hard, you need your time off. Excellent words of wisdom, Scott.
Yeah, thanks.
That's right, Scott. How can First Fleet encourage those leaving the military and finding their way in civilian life? How can we encourage them to come to First Fleet? Advertising better, you know, whether it's a brochure that lets them know that we're connecting with that group of people. I know there's transitioning military support groups that, you know, you can get involved with, but What is your advice there to help us to bring that group of people into First Fleet?
Yeah. Well, I always said, you know, since the terminal here is less than a mile from one of the main gates here on Fort Carson, mm-hmm. we should have like a banner on the fence out here.
Nice.
Right. Veteran friendly, or, you know, something like that. You know, we hire veterans or veteran friendly, you know, something like that out here on the fence, and just more advertising. And, you know, all the veterans we have working here, you know, just word of mouth.
Too. Right.
So
one suggestion was, you know, we have the veteran decal for our trucks, but maybe mm-hmm. adding something like, you know, veteran friendly, or, you know, something to the truck as well. So I think those are all ways to reach out.
Yes.
What about we've added cameras in the truck this year. That's something new that I think was new for everyone, but we've been installed for about a year now.
How do you feel about the Motive cameras, Scott?
Oh, you may not like this answer, Rob.
That's okay.
I already knew that. We're getting used to it.
Okay. Well, I feel like when you put them in, I feel like a little bit of our freedom was taken away, right? But I understand why they're in the truck, for the safety of the driver and the company, right?
Right.
But now I think not just me, a lot of us getting frustrated about the nitpicking of going maybe, you know, 2 or 3 miles over the speed limit, you know, and sometimes we have to.
Right.
Right.
Oh, sure.
You know, just there's common sense sometimes out there that you have to use, but I'm still not used to it. You know, it still reminds me sometimes, hey, you know, what you're doing. And it's hard to change your driving habits when
Absolutely.
You've been doing it for so long.
Absolutely.
Right? And you didn't think you're doing nothing wrong. And so, you know, like everything that comes out new, you know, it takes time to get used to.
That's right.
Like the when they went to the tablet, got rid of the log books, you know, a lot of us weren't for that. But now I think we are, because I wouldn't even know if I can do a logbook anymore.
That's what we hear so much. And that's fair on the Motive cameras as well. We really are just a full 12 months installed to some degree at different locations. And so we're learning and adjusting all the parameters, and we're taking feedback from drivers, and the safety team is involved heavily, of course. But the goal is to protect the driver and to bring the driver home safely to their family. So we do appreciate you working along with us. It's not without question for a lot of people. So it is, I appreciate your feedback.
I
understand. Yeah. We all understand that part about the safety feature of it.
So. Right. I would add to Rebecca's comment that the results that we're seeing with Motive cameras in incidents, they've trended down. It starts out, say, at a site, maybe 80 a week, and it trends down over the course of the first 2 weeks to about 50% of that. So maybe 40 on week 3. And then we see incremental decreases all the way down to where it gets down to normal. You know, I'd like to point out there's such a thing as a good hard break. If you're hitting the brakes to avoid a deer strike, that's not a strike against you in the camera.
As long as you don't swerve out of your lane.
That's right. And the camera shows that was a good hard break.
Yeah. And so, that's the reality of it.
Same thing. If someone pulls out in front of you, we want you to slam on the brakes and have a hard break to avoid an accident. So, yeah.
When Rob was here at the party a few weeks ago, he showed me a video, I believe it was in Nevada, Rob.
Yes.
Yeah, that was pretty scary, and what the camera picked up. So, you know, it has its good features, you know.
It does, and I think we're going to start seeing some, like the good reaction of the driver that I showed you in Nevada, that was a good teaching moment of why you cannot be distracted on the road. We're going to start celebrating these drivers.
Absolutely.
In terms of the drivers that are taking evasive action and doing the right things. Coming to a TV screen near you at one of the terminals, you're going to start seeing these good, positive moments captured. So,
it'll take time to get used to. That's all.
Totally understandable. I know, I feel like from the drivers that I've talked to, it's not until they have an instance where they proved that they were not at fault, and then they're suddenly very gung-ho for the cameras. I know we have several drivers that are very pro-camera because it helped them out in an accident situation to prove, hey, this was not me.
They were not at fault.
Exactly.
Well, I've always had my own camera before we got the cameras.
Right. That's what we're hearing.
Yeah, I know most people do. Yeah,
there was a lot of crazy stuff that, you know, that happened too. So
I know. I need to get a camera just so I can document the crazy people that are in front of me in Nashville traffic. It's amazing. dumb things people do when they're behind the wheel.
Right. And I think it's important also to point out, since we're talking about the motive cameras, that every FirstFleet employee that drives a company car has a motive camera. I had one of the first motive cameras in my company pickup and still have a camera in there today. And I'll say it's probably made me a better driver. Not probably, it's definitely made me a better driver and more aware of all the things. So we're all held to a similar standard. And it's important that everybody knows that it's not just the big red trucks that have it. My little white pickup has it as well. So,
and Scott, I have a camera as well. So I feel your pain.
Yeah, well, it hasn't been a year. I think they put them in here last October. Okay. So it hasn't been quite a year yet.
It's still growing pains and getting used to it.
Yeah.
Scott, we've been asking our veterans here at FirstFleet, what does being a veteran mean to you? And how does that impact you and affect you on a daily basis?
Well, I'm proud to be a veteran, all right? So I'm proud to be working here with all these veterans around me. Affecting just acknowledgement of being a veteran, you know, we're not looking for handouts. Just acknowledgement, thank you for your service. You know, that goes a long ways. And, you know, there's a lot of businesses around here are veteran friendly, you know, to give you discounts. That's all.
Definitely. We are proud to hire veterans here, and we're trying to recruit more, like Rebecca and Elizabeth were saying. So we really appreciate your feedback and everything.
Scott, this has been wonderful. I have really enjoyed getting to hear both from you and Mr. Rob Getz. I love hearing both of you guys. You'll have to come back soon on the podcast. But we just love that you are a veteran, love that we have so many veterans at our Fountain Terminal, which makes total perfect sense considering your location. And we're so glad that you've served our country, and now you are getting to work with us here at First Fleet, and you've brought the great values that you've learned along the way to your work here, and it shows. And I know just we've heard that from Rob, and so we just appreciate you so much.
Absolutely. I want to second that, what Eliz said. I want to thank Scott for your service, and also would like to thank all the veterans out there listening to this podcast for their service. You're very much appreciated, not just today on this podcast, but every day. And we want to continue to live that out at First Fleet.
Before we go today, I want to make sure that everyone understands we do have that veteran decal available for any driver that would like to reach out to us. Just send us the branch of service that you served in. And we offer those through Workhound. And if you have opted out of the Workhound messages, first you'll want to opt back in to Workhound by texting the word START to 48714, and you will start receiving messages again from Workhound. And then just send a simple message in saying you'd like more information about getting a veteran decal for your truck. So we'll drop some information in the show notes there. But I want to take back some information about a brochure for veterans getting into driving at First Fleet, and then the banner. I'd love to get a banner out there. I think the more we make ourselves publicly involved and interested in hiring veterans, then we'll be more successful.
Love it. So wonderful. Well, thank you all for your time here today. Really appreciate you joining the First Fleet podcast. And as always, drive safe.